Well, good morning. It's great to be together. Welcome, online church. I'm excited to be with you. It's another great day to be alive. God is on the throne, and He is good, and He loves us. What can be better news than that? He sent His Son, Jesus, and if we believe in Him, we have all that we need. So welcome, church family. Say hi to each other. Greet each other as we get ready to learn from God's word, to worship in song, to spend time in prayer, and to just be together during this time. Welcome. Let's start with a word of prayer. Dear God, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for this day, and we pray that you would guide us today, that in all that we do and say and sing and think, we bring you honor and glory. We pray that you would speak to us from your word, Jesus, that you would allow us to sense your presence very clearly and help us to grow closer to you. Holy Spirit, we invite you to fill each one of us and fill us as a church to become the people and the church you want us to be. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, January 10th, during our society meeting, we revealed New Day's new vision statement. And I just want to tell us about that as part of us starting Ephesians and learning what it means to be the kind of church that Jesus wants all of His churches to be. And at New Day, we've said that we want to be, our vision is to be a growing community of people wholeheartedly loving and following Jesus. Ephesians is going to be all about that. Loving and following Jesus. Our identity is going to be in Christ, and He's going to teach us how to be Christ followers and how to be the church. So a growing community, because we want to grow deeper individually in our identity and in our relationship with Jesus and in the way we live as followers of Christ. But also growing numerically, where we are bringing new people into relationship with Jesus. We can't do that, that's the Holy Spirit, but we want to be a people where people are drawn to who Jesus is and welcoming, so they want to be part of our community. We're gonna be a community because church is a group of people and we're not to do this alone. You can't be a lone range Christian. That is not the biblical idea of Christianity. Christianity is done in community. So we want to be a growing community of people, obviously, but people who are wholeheartedly with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength, just like Jesus says, we are to love God. First, the greatest commandment, to love your God, the Lord your God, with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. We want to wholeheartedly love and follow Jesus individually and as a community. And if we do that, we will be the church and we will be a light into our community. So our vision, a growing community of people wholeheartedly loving and following Jesus. And our slogan, and I want you to say this with me, I'll say it once and then we'll say it again together. The slogan is love God, love people, live like Jesus. Ready? Love God, love people, live like Jesus. Ready? Let's do it one more time. Love God, love people, live like Jesus. That's the simple version of the vision and the mission. So you're going to see this on Facebook, on the website, on a sign in the church and different places. We are going to put our vision up because that's who we want to be, that's where we're heading, and we want to keep reminding ourselves.
You uphold the one who feels forsaken. forsaken. You are faithful, God. Faithful, forever you are faithful. Lover of the wounded heart, you defend the poor and the forgotten. You are faithful, God. And I will sing to the Maker of heaven and earth. God, you reign forever, and your love will endure. Faithful and true is the name of the Lord. You are faithful, God. Faithful, forever you are faithful. I will sing to the Maker of heaven and earth. God, you reign forever, and your love will endure. Faithful and true is the name of the Lord. You are faithful, God.
Faithful, God.
Yes, you are. You are faithful, God.
Apostle of Jesus Christ, that's what he calls himself, by the will of God. Don't think this is on my own merit or this was my idea. No, it's God who sent me to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. Saints is a confusing word, maybe not to those who've journeyed in the church for a long time. We're used to the fact that we are saints, or maybe we're not. But for outsiders, it just sounds weird. For people coming from maybe a different stream of Christianity, this is a sign to those who were especially amazing in life and now have been awarded sainthood posthumously, post-death. Or it's for those super holy people or perceived super holy people. But that is not what the word saint means. Saint means holy ones. It's a sign. It can mean holy things or holy people, and it means to be set apart for a purpose. It comes from the Old Testament times, that the things and people were consecrated, set apart for the service to God. So saints are soldiers, are people set apart, separated, consecrated for the work of God. And so to the saints, the holy ones, and it's God, is both a privilege, right, to be set apart for God, but a responsibility. With it comes now the, I don't get to live for myself anymore. I'm set apart for God's work and God's purpose. Now the job is then to figure out what is God's purpose for me, and we get to that later. No reason to not start praying about that now. But it is it's an amazing privilege to be set apart because we believe in Jesus, but it's also a responsibility. So with that, what are you going to do with that? What is the work God has for you to do? And as long as you're breathing, there's something for us to do as set apart ones. And it's the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. So the way the letter is written, it does really, like the Greek apparently does really create there's supposed to be a location filled in. So maybe if it was a circular letter, they just read the location in wherever it arrived. But in this case, this one preserved is from Ephesus. And to the faithful, which means to either have faith or show faithfulness, and probably both in this. And it's the faithful in Christ Jesus. Saints, by God's grace, who sanctifies us and setting us apart, we're believers and faithful, because faith ultimately is God's gift, allowing us to lay hold of salvation. And the faithful are believers whose calling is to faithfulness. We are to have our faith in Him, our life is in Him, and all satisfaction and all our needs are met with Him. So we have an identity as holy ones set apart. We are called to a purpose for that reason, and so that's a responsibility. We are also called faithful in Christ Jesus, not faithful on our own. I'm not faithful on our yet. I'm faithful in Christ Jesus. And that is both having faith and living out faithfulness, being faithful, having faith in Him and having my life in Him. That's what's in this first section. And it's interesting because Paul in this letter, as he does in the letter to the Colossians, is distinguishing that we have a physical location in Ephesus or in Colossae, right? And we have a kingdom location in Christ. In Colossians, it's a little clearer how that he combines the two concepts. And in Colossians, it reads this in verse 2. To the saints and faithful brethren and sisters, brothers and sisters, in Christ who are in Colossae. So we are in Christ, first of all, and then we're in the location down here. So when we are to set apart once with a purpose and faithful in Christ Jesus, where we're having faith in Him and with that a responsibility to live faithfully, is both in His kingdom but at a location. God created you to be you at this time in the place where you are for the purpose that He has. And it is by His will that we're called to do what God has for us to do. Just like God had something for Paul to do, which is a big thing. And aren't we grateful that he actually did what he was called to do? Because we would be without all these books in the New Testament. God could have used someone else, but Paul said yes. And so that's my hope for us. And then the greeting from Paul is grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace, the word is kairos, and it means free, undeserved love and favor from God. And it is means restoring, that grace is restoring us to God and addressing every need we have. And peace is from, is irene in Greek, but it is from the concept of shalom in Hebrew, and it means wholeness, but it also, I've heard it said just recently, it is the binding of chaos. So it's, in a sense, and the one who creates chaos. So there is a peace. There's no chaos. There's no turmoil. There's wholeness. But it's peace with God, first of all, because God's grace, by giving us Jesus, allows us to have peace with God. We're no longer enemies. And then it allows us to have peace within ourselves, because we're no longer having to live in chaos or turmoil, because Jesus bought peace for us with God, and we can be free from guilt and shame and sin and all the burdens that we normally carry. And then the third part is that we can have peace with each other. And all these things matter. And it all has to do ultimately with identity. And that peace comes from God, our Father. Not God the Creator, not God the Almighty, but God our Father. It's a relational experience that Paul is reminding us of. Our identity is changed. We are called, we are saints, we're holy ones set apart, we are the faithful in Christ Jesus, and we are God's children. So He is our Father, and so Paul is wishing us grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is saying that God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ are both God, because He's comparing them. We of course already know that, but this is just one more place. But it's also that the grace and peace comes from God the Father, but arrives to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. There would be no grace and peace to us without Jesus purchasing that for us. And ultimately we know, and we will get to later, that it's the Holy Spirit then that makes it real for us in our hearts and our lives. So that's Ephesians 1, 1 and 2. So we heard in Christ Jesus in the first sentence, and in Christ in the and through the Lord Jesus Christ in the second sentence, and of Jesus Christ, the apostle. So it's interesting that in Christ or in Him are mentioned 10 times in the first 8 sentences and 11 times in verses 1 through 14. So it is in Christ, through Christ, by Christ, for Christ. Everything is in Christ. So who we are and what we are is meant to be found in Jesus. Who we are and what we are is meant to be found in Jesus. This whole, these two verses end up talking a lot about our identity. It's God's will. He created us for His purpose. So our identity is part of His will. He created you and me for a reason. And He is inviting us to live into that identity, to not compare to another, to not try to be someone you're not, to not wear masks and hide who you are, but to be you, but to be more fully you, the saint that God created you to be, the set apart one, to live more fully into your true identity, become all that God desires for you to be. But that only happens in Christ, that freedom, that wholeness, that shalom wholeness, the completeness of who you are only happens in Christ. And in Christ, our identity is set apart one, saints and faithful. Even when you don't feel like you are holy and you don't feel like you are faithful, you are still declared that by God. You're still set apart. Now live like it, right? You're still a faithful one because you have said yes to Jesus by faith. So now we have the responsibility to live as faithful people. But our identity is who we are in Christ. And as such, we are called to live in holiness and called to be faithful. For Christians, our life is in Christ. Just like a bird is in the air, and a fish is in the sea, and a vine is in the branch. all those things exist in the environment that they're created for. We are created for existing in the environment of being in Christ. And in Christ, we have life and all that we need. So that's what I want to leave you with. And I want to ultimately ask you to think about some things. One of the devotionals I looked at challenged us, and I haven't done it yet, so I'm going to do it with you, is to, in the same 30 words, because Paul used 30 words in this section in the Greek, to write out with your identity. So verse 1, 30 words. What is your identity in Christ? Write that out this week. Base it on these verses, base it on something else, but what is your identity? Write that out so you can claim it and remember it. And you might feel weird writing that you're a saint or that you're the faithful, but that's what God says. This letter is addressed to the Ephesians, probably, but it's actually addressed to the church. So everyone who is in Christ, everyone who is a believer, this is a letter to you, and you are called. You are being greeted by Paul, who is an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. You are called a saint and a faithful person, and not in Ephesus, but in wherever you are. So that's my challenge. Let's write out our identity statement. And then I would like you to chew on these verses for this week and just really read them over and over and ask God, you know, what is His will for your life? How are you feeling about being a saint? And what is that? What is the responsibility that comes with that for you? And what does it mean to be faithful in Christ Jesus? What does it mean to be and live in Christ Jesus? And are you experiencing God's grace? Are you embracing that? And are you receiving His peace? I want you to wrestle with this, because this book is about who we are in Christ. The whole book is. And who we are in Christ as a church. And what God's idea is that the church should be. Not humans. Because Jesus is the head of the church, as we will learn in this book. And we want to be the church that He wants us to be. So that's what I want to leave you with. Now, if you've joined us and you've wandered off from your faith, like maybe you had as a kid, or maybe you've never said yes to Jesus, and you're like, hey, I want all that God has to offer. I want that free, undeserved love and favor. I want peace and absence of chaos. I want to have an identity where I'm set apart and I'm called faithful. Then it's simple. You either return to Jesus or you say yes to Jesus for the first time. It means admitting that you've sinned, that you're a sinner, asking for forgiveness, believing that Jesus is the Son of God who came to offer us freedom from death and offer us eternal life by believing in Him, that He came from the Father to pay for all our sins so that we, by believing in Him, could be free of all that guilt and receive eternal life, and then inviting Him to come into your heart and life. If you want to say yes to a relationship with Jesus and no longer have to wrestle with this on your own, but receive all that you need to live a life that makes sense, then I invite you to say yes to Him today and pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner, and I ask You for Your forgiveness. I believe, Jesus, that You are the Messiah, that You are the Son of God, that You were sent by the Father to be the Savior of the world and to be my Savior, and that You paid for every single one of my sins. And that if I believe that You paid for that and accept Your payment and believe that You are offering me eternal life, that I can live with You and have a relationship with You and Father God and the Holy Spirit forever. So I invite You to come into my heart and life and to start this relationship with me. And I ask You to teach me how to follow You and how to live in You, Jesus, in Christ, so that in You I have my identity, I have peace, and I have all that I need. And I thank You in Jesus' name. Lord God, for all of us who've said yes to Jesus before, would You help us to reclaim our identity in Christ and to step away from all the stuff that has confused us during this confusing time that we live in with disease around us and economic challenges and political challenges and maybe relationship challenges, and that we would not focus on all that we are not, but rather recommit to who we are in you. Would you help us with that? And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I hope that this message will inspire you and that you're excited for where we're going to go in Ephesians.
I searched the world. It couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. You came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid.
thank you so much for joining us. I hope this time together was just a wonderful thing for all of us, and that you felt God's presence, and that you are just ready for a new week, and that you will have a great rest of your day. And with Paul's word, I want to just give you this blessing. May the grace of God and the peace from God be on you as you continue in this day, as you continue in your week, and as you walk with God and receive from Him all that He has in store for you. Be blessed.